vroeg vanochtend het Donald Trump sy staatsrede gelever. Môre is dit Ramaphosa se beurt. Ons bekyk die belang van hierdie twee toesprake. Later in die program kan jy ook die DA se nuwe burgemeesterskandidaat vir Tshwane ontmoet. Maar eers, die EFF het sy verkiesingsmanifest die naweek bekendgestel. Steven Tau was daar.
Die EFF het oor die afgelope naweek hulle verkiesingsmanifest in Soshanguve, noord van Pretoria, bekendgestel. Daar was 'n feestelike atmosfeer. Partyondersteuners het van reg oor die land gekom om te luister na wat Julius Malema en sy party se planne vir die land is. Die planne is saamgevat in 'n enorme manifest van 170 bladsye.
Die EFF sê as hulle regeer, sal hulle seker maak elke skool het 'n ortodontis, 'n swembad, 2 sportvelde, gratis vervoer vir leerlinge wat meer as 2 km van 'n skool af woon, 'n tabletrekenaar vir elke kind en die lys van hierdie beloftes gaan net aan.
Volgens Malema moet Suid-Afrikaners daarop aandring om die volgende te hê.
There shouldn't be a house in South Africa without water, without a toilet, without electricity. If you don't have those three, it's not human settlement.
Hy het ook beloftes gemaak van wat werkers glo onder 'n EFF regering sal verdien.
All mine workers, the entry level must be 12,500 for all the mine workers who are at an entry level. The farm workers, 5,000. Manufacturing workers, 6,500. Retail workers, 5,000. Builders will earn a salary of 7,000. Petrol attendants, 6,500. Cleaners, 4,500. Domestic workers, 5,000. Security guard, 7,500. Waiters and waitresses, 4,500. Comrades, that is just an entry level.
Die EFF wil ook maatskaplike toelaas verdubbel en alle grond nasionaliseer. Oor korrupsie het Malema beloof dat hulle seker sal maak dat elke korrupte politikus gestraf gaan word. Hy het sy ondersteuners gevra om die EFF se boodskap te versprei.
Let us go and fight. Don't be scared. Don't be a coward. Go door to door, person to person, street by street, factory by factory, university by university, school by school. Talk to our people.
Malema se boodskap het aanklank gevind by EFF-lede soos hierdie.
What he does is nice, grateful in a way. And then I would encourage the youth to vote for him.
It is possible to EFF to win. Yeah. It should roll our country.
Ek verwelkom nou vir Pieter Louis Meiburg, skrywer en ondersoekende journalist, Theo Venter, beleidsontleder verbonde aan die NWI Sakeskool, en ook Ralph Mateka, skrywer en onafhanklike politieke ontleder. Ralph, I'm going to start with you. Whose document is this manifesto? Because we know there are smart people in the EFF, highly educated people, but honestly, to promise 10% economic growth in 2 years, guaranteed jobs, only locally procured food, I can go on and on, a million rand per PhD, this is ridiculous. Who wrote this?
Well, first of all, it is too long. I mean, I think it goes over 100 pages, even longer than
170,
longer than that of the ANC. But I think that reading this manifesto, you get a sense that this is not a political party that thinks it will be held accountable to some of those things. There are certain manifestos that you can see, they are just there to establish, just to challenge the system. But even the political party that has adopted such kind of a manifesto, they know that they will not be in charge of anything. And their promises are actually to say that, look, we're not going to be in charge of anything. We might as well promise just about everything. Yeah. After all, we won't be held accountable to any of these things. I mean, these elections for the EFF, it's a referendum on radicalism. Mm. For them, they're going to test how far is allowable and to look at how much they get at the
box. Ja, maar in 'n sekere sin was hierdie nie noodwendig eers so radikaal nie. Dis meer belaglik as radikaal, Theo, want hulle het iets vir almal dan gehad. Daar selfs vir maatskappye is daar iets as special economic zones. Jy weet, dis asof hulle probeer het met die haalgeweer benader om almal in die land te bring.
Ek dink dis Dr. Ndlozi wat hom geskryf het. Hy het onlangs sy PhD klaar gemaak en dan is hy ou gewoonlik in hierdie by waar jy lang goed wil skryf en akademiese goed. Dit klink vir my soos 'n verhandeling. Nee, ek stem met Ralph saam.
Goed, maar dis 'n verhandeling deur iemand, Theo, wat die ekonomie klaarblyklik glad nie verstaan nie.
of hulle weergawe van die ekonomie het, of soos wat ons in verskeie plekke al gesien
het. Nee, maar daar is nie weergawe van die ekonomie nie. Ek bedoel, jy moet inkomste.
Ja, daar is beslis weergawe.
Nee, maar jy moet inkomste om te betaal vir wat hulle beloof.
Ja, maar jy moet nou nie dat die feite jou ideologiese persepsie nou die mekaar maak. Maar dis wat ons hier het. As jy na Hugo Chavez kyk, oorlede Hugo Chavez van Venezuela, en jy kyk wat het ons vandag daar, dis ideologie teenoor feite. Dieselfde wat ons op baie ander plekke kry. So, dis ideologiese dokument.
Pieter Louis, wie reken jy is die tekengehoor van so 'n dokument? Ons het nou gespekuleer oor wie daar agter skuil. Ja. Maar wie het hierna geluister? Wie lees hierdie manifest en sê... Dit is die type partij wat ons nodig het.
Ek denk nie, het gaan uitwendig oor die persoon wat het gaan lees, die 170 bladsy en gaan analyseer nie, maar het gaan oor die baie populistische quick hits wat hulle in die document deurgevoer het. En ek denk, het is een verlengstuk van die type beleid wat ons al vroeger gesien het, hulle duidelik navolg in die type persoon wat wil loop. Hulle was baie sterk achter gratis hoër onderwijs gewees. Ons sien het nou weer, het is opgebring hier so in die document. Ons het al vroeger gesien van die, ek denk, een van die stukke wat een bykie debat voering kan spaak, is hier die idee van een kleiner, of tenminste, meer gecentraliseerde regering en minder provincies en weet so dat daar een sterker centrale regering is wat oor die land regeer. Maar ek denk oor die geheel gesien, ek bedoel, die document is absoluut tone deaf en blind vir die realiteite van die land oor die afgelope paar jaar. Ek bedoel, nou kom die EFF, ons is nou besig om te worstel met die absolute gemors waarin die staatsbeheerde maatskappy in die land is. Hulle voorstel is om meer staatsbeheerde maatskappy te hê. Hulle wil 'n soewereine wealth fund stig om ekonomiese groei in die land te stimuleer. Die alarmklokkie wat in my kop afgaan en dit is natuurlik WBS, jy weet. Daai is ook 'n sovereign wealth fund gewees wat absoluut geplunder was deur lede van die EFF en nou wil hulle hê, jy weet, belastingbetalers moet geld op sy sit vir soet. So
okay, so Ralph, maybe the statist approach is, you know, is tone deaf to our disillusionment with government control. But there are supporters of the EFF who would argue that the EFF is the party that best articulates South Africans' anger you know, at what's been happening over the last decade, articulating this popular rage and also what people actually want. I mean, surely many people would listen to this and say, okay, I would like that.
Yeah. Well, at times it becomes quite childish what they're proposing. I mean, they're good to listen to when they're challenging power in parliament.
And they're entertaining to listen to.
They're very entertaining to listen to. But look at the percentage that they have. With what they're putting on the table, they're not going to win. They're not going to win the elections. I think that they cultivate on the anger that exists among South Africans. But they also take it too far. I mean, for what they're saying to work, it's not just about a new government coming into being. It's a completely new system. It's an overhaul. They're talking about a system where there are no tenders at all and so forth. It's a complete overhaul of the current system that we have. It takes more than just a new government to come in.
Fine. I mean, I think people would agree with you that they won't govern nationally this year, but they could be a kingmaker in Gauteng. That's absolutely not impossible. You know, and with a manifesto like this, I mean, you know, they might try to push through some of these in as much as provinces have a say, you know, who knows whether they'll be part of the Gauteng government?
They could become a kingmaker in Gauteng, but that does not mean that they usually maximize on that position. I mean, they have been in a position of a kingmaker in Tshwane and in the city of Johannesburg. Does that make them kings? No, they are not. Actually, they could not even maximize in the coalitions that they've entered into. They are not clear what they stand for. I think that for a voter, it's about what system am I actually voting for? Voting against the current system is one thing, but to really vote for what is being put on the table is quite another altogether.
So kiesers is onseker, sê Ralf. Pieter Louis sê kiesers is ontnugter met staatsbeheer. Dink jy dat kiesers, wanneer hulle hierdie type beloftes hoor, 2019, ons demokrasie is daarom nou al 25 jaar oud, oortuig word deur hierdie tipe beloftes, dit ernstig opneem? Dink dit het hoegenaamd realisties is?
Wel, elke politieke partij het een manifest van 'n soort. En die gewone kiezer lees om nie. Dit is soos baie ander dokumente in die politiek. Jy luister vir 'n paar hoofpunte van 'n paar politici en jy hang jou hele idee vir wie jy gaan ondersteun daaraan en dan is die Suid-Afrikaanse kiezer geweldig vastgeanker aan brandnames, aan wie hy ondersteun. Dis hoekom ons die ANC gesien het in 2016, dat die mees radikale beweging van die kiezer was om weg te bly ek gaan liever nie stem nie, as om 'n keuse te maak tussen hier en daar. Oor die EFF wil ek net sê, in die plaaslike owerheidsomgewing, wat ek nou redelik goed ken, is die gewone man op straat, is al klaar van mening, dat die EFF besig is met pie in the sky. Want politici is kompromie, en die gewone op straat weet het, En ek dink Ralf het reeds gesê, hierdie lang dokument, hierdie beloftes van hulle, ergens langs die pad gaan hulle kompromis moet maak. En dan val die hele ding, en dan kom die verkiesing, en dan generate hulle gauw 'n bietjie weer radikalisme, en na die verkiesing dan val hy weer af.
Is hierdie, Pieter Louis, die type retoriek van 'n party wat vol selfvertroue is, dat hy gaan groei in die volgende verkiesing, of liewers 'n spartelende desperaat?
Ek sal met die tweede optie gaan. Ek dink is 'n party wat steier onder 'n onlangse korrupsieskandaal. Ek dink is ene wat nou nog meer populisties en nog groter beloftes moet maak. Ek bedoel, ons kyk na beloftes wat strek van gratis ortodontiese by elke skool in Suid-Afrika, swembaddens by elke skool, en dan natuurlik die verdubbeling van maatskaplike toelaas is ook een van die groot dinge op hulle lys.
'N party wat sy belangrikste bemarkingsman, Zuma, verloor het.
Ek dink hulle is absoluut bewus van die onrealistiese aard van hierdie dokument. Ek dink is 'n party wat gedink het, kom ons gooi soveel jy weet, vrugte daar uit en kyk hoeveel mense bereid is om dit op te tel. Ek dink daar is baie Suid-Afrikaners wat deur hierdie dokument gaan sien.
Want gepraat van Zuma, ek dink jy is reg, maar gepraat van Zuma, Theo, net 2 weke gelede het Malema gesê, hy vergewe Zuma sy sondes, op dieselfde manier as wat Mandela, die apartheidsregering, vergewe het Floyd Shivambu op SABC verduidelik. Hy het net gesê, ons gaan nie vergeet nie, maar ons vergewe. Hoe kan jy in een asem minimum vonnisse vir veroordeelde korruptes bepleit, soos wat Malema weer het Saterdag, en in die ander asem vir Zuma vergewe? Hoe ruim dit?
En dis wat charismatiese leiers doen. Hulle bou hulle leierskap uit, hulle het hierdie dubbelsinnigheid wat hulle in hulle, die Engelse woord ambiguity, wat hulle in hulle leierskapsprofiel het, en dis precies wat hy doen. Ek dink nie, hy bedoel enige een van hierdie nie.
It's not the politics of principles what you're seeing. And remember one thing that they keep on proving and they want people to forget. They come from the ANC.
Yeah, absolutely.
There is still the culture. They cannot win themselves away from the culture of benefiting unduly from the state. That is why they are so compromised when it comes to their position on corruption. I mean, fundamentally, they took money from an alleged tobacco smuggler for crying out loud. It means that you cannot count on them on such kind of policies that are meant to actually uproot corruption as well. So it's not the politics of principle, it is the politics of convenience here.
Rolf, I don't know whether you were at the dinner on Friday night where Karine Duplessis tweeted pictures of the very lovely Rupert and Rothschild red wine that was served to EFF guests at the banquet. Who is funding their campaign? Because, you know, the event on Saturday also wasn't cheap, right?
Apparently, they're actually promising to go to court about the implementation of this new bill.
Constitutional court.
That is,
really,
yes, about the
party funding.
About party funding. They want to challenge that because clearly they cannot explain, they're not willing to open their books with regard to that. Even that, the story that we know, that how can you, as a party that you say you are an alternative, be funded by people who are dealing with these allegations? They don't even want to discuss that. It's a non-starter for them.
So is this a middle-class party or a working-class party?
This is just an angry party that has been formed not out of any commitment to a particular principle. It is a party that has been created by the conditions under Zuma. These are the legacy of Zuma, actually. That's the EFF itself.
Okay, there we pause. Bly ingeskakel. Net hierna gesels ek verder met die paneel oor wat op die spel is wanneer Ramaphosa môre sy staatsrede lewer.